Hello, welcome to Worldline Paytech Bytes. Today we'll be discussing an interesting topic, API-first payment. Is an invisible checkout experience possible? To help us understand this subject, we have with us Mr. Venkat Narayanan, Associate Vice President Product at Worldline India. Venkat, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
So, Venkat, let's set the stage, you know, with more businesses embraces digital commerce, you know, providing, you know, customer preferred payment method is becoming important. So one approach, you know, companies are taking is the payment APIs. So what makes API first payment such a promising solution for businesses aiming to streamline their checkout processes?
Let's start with some simple terms, right? What is an API?
Yeah.
Right. It is actually just a code which helps or facilitates communication between two software programs or applications.
Okay.
Now, in the payments landscape, you can generalize or equate it to a lot of examples. For example, when a merchant application is trying to securely connect to its payment partner,
okay,
or financial institution or bank for a transaction request.
Okay.
If you look at a payments company like Worldline, we have multiple systems, right? We have multiple applications to manage the entire merchant base.
Okay.
These applications need to connect or communicate with each other.
Okay.
For facilitating services, like for example, it could be onboarding a merchant, it could be managing the merchant lifecycle, managing a transaction lifecycle, it could be for managing refunds, disputes, right, to generate reports, or even for fund supplement.
Okay.
So, and if I take a global approach, if I look at the payment ecosystem, then there are these partner banks.
Okay.
You also have the regulatory bodies. They also tend to communicate. They also tend to reach out to the payment partners or the payment entities to fetch specific data points as and when business requires.
So okay.
APIs are omnipresent. They are everywhere, right? Now, as the name suggests, an API-first approach is an approach towards product development, which focuses on, you know, defining and building or developing your APIs first, even before the underlying products are built, right? This goes a long way in driving many benefits.
Okay.
And you can categorize these benefits to functional benefits, which are, you know, more business oriented, and technical benefits, which are more oriented towards product development initially.
Okay.
For example, you know, having an API first approach will help merchants to build one of the best payment experiences for their customers.
Okay.
Right? And how it helps. By doing that, they can drive up their conversion rate. So that's a metric that they benefit
from. Okay.
They can ensure that their order fulfillment keeps growing the moment they point towards that payment partner.
Okay. Right?
These are the metrics they can see directly. From a products company, like be it a payments company or an e-commerce, an API first as a strategy for product development helps you ship your products much faster.
Okay.
Because it brings in agility into the product development or application development lifecycle. So you are able to hit the market at the right time, right? So your go-to-market effectiveness increases many folds.
Okay.
And you can also say that there are certain things inherent to the API-first approach,
okay,
which also includes testing your application at various stages as it is developed.
Okay.
Right? Or as it is being developed. What it helps is it helps you bring down errors.
Okay.
Right? And these errors usually manifest as bugs when the product is near to release. But then you can handle it much earlier.
Right?
So these are clear metrics from a business point of view. Now when I look at technical point of view, from a product development standpoint, I can say that an API-first approach helps greater adoption within the product development teams.
Okay.
Okay, because it focuses on maintaining API-level documentation, managing the entire API lifecycle.
Okay.
And build a proper governance around this. Right? And that really helps faster adoption and excellent return on investment for product development companies.
Okay.
And lastly, you can also say that compliance and security. Those requirements usually come as a showstopper when you are near the product release.
I know. Yeah.
Right. But when you go with an API first approach, because the connectivity is being addressed earlier, you can address all the compliance and security issues much earlier.
Okay.
So there are plethora of benefits.
So when we talk about invisible checkout experience, so what do you really mean, both from a customer or an merchant perspective? And do you think, is it really possible to create a truly, fully invisible checkout experience?
Well, it's going to be a long answer. So, because there are different parts to your
question. Okay.
Right? So,
but if you can, you know, highlight it in brief.
I was trying my best. So for example, if you see invisible payments is a scenario where the customer doesn't really have to engage any of the systems while executing the transaction. Right? For example, usually customer needs to select the payment option or enter certain credentials to validate, do some passwords, etc. All these things happen in an invisible payment as well. But generally, this happens in the background. Right?
Yeah.
And this happens automatically with minimal or no intervention.
Yeah.
Right? Now, when you say whether such payments are truly possible, the answer is really yes.
Okay.
It is possible. And you can take a lot of examples, right? In fact, you can even go back a few years. And with the genesis of the one-time mandate-based recurring products, right? There is little and minimal intervention from the customer to register the mandate. But then all the subsequent transactions are auto-debited.
Auto-debited.
And there is no intervention in the customer's point. And these has been available for so many years. There are a number of mandate-based products for payments. There are physical mandates, digital mandates. There are mandates on UPI, there are one-time mandate, OTP-based mandate, you name it, it's there. Financial services industry has capitalized on this for many years.
Okay.
Right? And majority of their collections are completely automated. The intervention is only at the time of sale, when the customer is being onboarded and the mandate is being
Okay.
A modern-day equivalent to that would be all your digital content and streaming platforms. If you have signed up, Pritesh, for any one of them, you would have registered at the time of sign up. You would have registered with the mandate. You would have linked your payment account, card or bank account. You just watch content and then it's
doing. For example, I have Netflix subscription. So I, you know, I don't remember when I, you know, signed the mandate actually. Yes. So it's been automatically getting debited every
month. Just focus on consumption, right? That experience becomes
better. Right.
Now, if you also look at modern day retail, for example, today retail stores have completely cashier-free self-checkout kiosks. So you can just, as a customer, walk in. There is a powerful camera.
Correct.
There is an RFID scanner. Right? And that's linked to a payment interface. There is even a dedicated self-serve tag removal capability. You just put the products into the basket. They get scanned. The card gets created. You do contactless payment and you just leave the products. And it's become so great today that, you know, I was just recently trying to buy a refrigerator and I realized that there are no smart refrigerator. Right? And these actually track the consumption of products inside. There is a camera in window and there is a completely integrated touchscreen which is interactive for the customers. And all your favorite marketplace and shopping applications are already pre-installed. And I can simply add my payment option over there. Right?
Okay.
The fridge will actually tell me when I'm running out of something.
Interesting.
It'll create the cart.
Okay.
And basis just my consent, it'll go old.
Okay.
Right? So, when you say from a customer standpoint what it means that my waiting time is brought down to zero. Hardly any waiting
time. Yeah.
Right? It's an enriching shopping experience. Right? And I do not have to remember anything, credentials. I don't even have to carry my cart.
I agree. Right? Yeah.
And where we stand today with the embedded payments scenario, which with the IoT and smart devices coming into the fray, you don't even need an instrument, right? You can just tap your device and execute the transaction.
Correct.
How it will manifest in future, I see that with the integration of maybe voice-based controls or even gesture-based controls and driving those capability for transaction initiation, and building a whole biometric or, you know, facial recognition based authentication process can actually make the payments truly invisible.
Okay, going interesting. Forward. So, for businesses considering an API-first payment solution, so what advice would you give to them as they navigate this shift?
I think from an advisory standpoint, we can look at both, right? API-first approach as well as invisible things.
Hmm.
Now, one need not, you should not forget ever that what made API-based approach so special.
Yeah.
Right? API-first approach is special because you need to create those meticulous testing regimes.
Hmm.
So my advice would be that don't put in the X.
Okay.
Keep maintaining that because that's where the advantages really lie, right? Again, the whole process of creating API documentation, managing the API lifecycle, right, and building a governance around it is extremely important, right? If you don't do that, you will lose out on the thing.
Okay.
When it comes to invisible payments, right, I can say that my advice for how things might change
in
the future is that there is going to be a significant shift.
Okay.
Right? From proprietary technology and standard,
okay.
We will be moving towards more generic or global standards. Right? The regulatory bodies will play its due course.
Okay.
My advice to payment companies and e-commerce companies would be that they should be able to create sufficient awareness for the end customer.
Okay.
Because so many things happening at the background.
I know.
Right? Yeah. So there should be a way for providing disclosures or notifications to the customer.
Hmm.
So that as a customer, I can keep a track of what's happening with my bank account or my card account.
Okay.
Right? These kind of capabilities need to be, again, combined with a robust grievance redressal program, right?
Okay.
Because those kind of processes will only build the confidence in the end customer and increase the adoption of such payment options in the future.
Okay.
Right? And lastly, you cannot get away from data security and privacy.
That is important.
Because while there will be guidelines around it, and these are invisible payments, so inherent nature of them, you cannot ignore. So regulatory pressure aside and the guidelines aside, I think companies, both product companies in payments and e-commerce, will have to make sure that they make use of what they have. What they have is data.
Okay. Yeah.
They need to build analytics around it. They need to build their own measures for monitoring risk.
Okay.
They need to understand the buying behavior. They need to understand the transaction or the payment patterns for customers based on the type of channels that they are using. And by implementing all of this, I believe, you know, it's not too much to ask for, but I think by implementing this, you can truly ace both the API-first approach as well as invisible safe.
Okay. Thank you so much, Venkat, for your insights today. It's been an enriching conversation.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
To all our listeners, thank you for tuning in today. Don't forget to like, share and subscribe Worldline Paythegwise. We will see you next time with another interesting topic and guest. Till then, take care and stay tuned.